While Puerto Ricans are sweltering in the dark, a big debate is breaking out about how or if to restore the island's battered and under-resourced public electrical grid. The Puerto Rico Electric Power Authority is the biggest public utility in the United States. It's currently bankrupt with $9 billion in debt, they say. Puerto Ricans pay more for electricity than nearly all of their fellow Americans, except perhaps people in Hawaii, and they get most of their power from dirty oil-fired plants that are prone to blackouts even when there isn't a storm. Capitalists have their sights set on taking the system out of public hands, shifting to a, quote, well-regulated private utility and making it make money. That's the point of the private part. Is that the only option? Might there be others? And what's next? For answers to these questions and more, I am happy to be joined by David Galarza Santa. He is a labor and community activist right here in the New York area and very involved on these issues. David, welcome to the program. Glad to have you.
Thank you for having me, Laura.
So we've heard it over and over again. This is a humanitarian crisis. The electricity needs to come back on. The next sentence depends on where your interests lie. What do you say about what needs to happen right now with respect to the electrical grid?
Well, what needs to happen right now is to make sure that we don't go back to the Puerto Rico that existed before this storm. We're weathering an economic storm of, you know, of epic proportions, which is the junta and then this whole Promesa bill that was enacted by Congress. Supposedly, the people in Puerto Rico owe billions and billions of dollars to these hedge fund vultures and so forth. And so people are already being strapped in terms of their economic situation. Now comes this storm, and it's literally, you know, the perfect storm to try and do the kinds of things that this junta initially was pledged to do, or the Promesa bill was pledged to do. There's an item in the Promesa bill that says that they can do anything they want to do in fast-track energy projects, for instance, in Puerto Rico, without public oversight and the public scrutiny that most public projects would have to undergo. That's very scary to us because, yeah, it means the privatization of the grid. It means perhaps restarting this whole debate or this whole fight against these pipelines that they wanted to build in Puerto Rico. It means basically getting stuck to the old way of generating energy in Puerto Rico when Puerto Rico is an island just 100 by 35 miles in the Caribbean where the sun shines nearly every single day and can be powered by sustainable energy. I'm so happy to work with, and I've been working now with for several years, an organization in the middle of the island called Casa Pueblo de Adjuntas. The founder there, Alexis Masol, was a recipient of the Goldman Prize, which is like the Nobel Peace Prize for environmental work. Alexis and the people in Casa Pueblo won that award some 30 years ago because they fought successfully two multinational mining companies that wanted to rip apart that whole area for extract minerals and other resources in Puerto Rico. And they said no, and they organized, and they formed this organization called Casa Pueblo, which is totally sustainable, no government funding, no other kind of funding that would compromise their integrity and their independence. And they remain with us till today, 40 years later, fighting the good fight, and they've taken it upon themselves to make sure that this opportunity right now, for lack of a better word, is used to the best of our ability collectively to get us off the grid and get us off fossil fuels.
So talk about what that plan might look like, because a lot of people talk about it. Can they actually implement?
It's called Iluminar Puerto Rico. Let's illuminate Puerto Rico with the sun. And so very concretely, they put out a call, they're raising money, and there's tons of people that responded all over the diaspora. But more importantly, our allies in just environmental justice have responded. I mean, I've gotten calls and I've spoken to people all over that want to get involved, whether it be solar generation or solar lights or small solar apparatuses that can power the things that people use when they have up respiratory diseases, you know, the respirators and things of that matter. And then there are even companies here, for instance, in New York and in Brooklyn that I've been in touch with that can provide all kinds of solar panels to get people to start thinking this way, because we have to rebuild, but we have to resist that temptation or that inclination to go back to the way things were. Right now, Puerto Rico is in a place environmentally that's a disaster.
You're not the only person to notice that there's a relationship between these massive, more powerful than any in U.S. recorded history hurricanes that hit the Caribbean and Puerto Rico in quick succession this fall. It's not impossible that you would find a private interest in the United States that says, actually, we see there's a climate problem. Let's rebuild the grid solar. Would that be okay with you and the people of Casa Pueblo?
They have to consult with the people of Puerto Rico first and foremost. There are many green capitalists, so to speak. For instance, just a couple of years ago in Puerto Rico, some entrepreneur wanted to put wind energy turbines in the southern part of Puerto Rico in an area that was disputed because it was also rich agricultural lands. And people were just like, yeah, we want sustainable energy, but don't you think you should put this someplace else? So they put these windmills up, and guess what? There's no wind. So you got to do it with the right kind of thinking, the right kind of input, and the right kind of support, on the grassroots level. Casa Pueblo has that. You know, there are people that really have a commitment to conservation and to building Puerto Rico from the ground up. And that's it's a phenomenal organization, and how come they have that kind of respect and admiration throughout Puerto Rico?
So let's talk about the ground up. I have to say, whenever I hear certainly an American president talk about Puerto Rico's debts, it reminds me of, British colonials talking about the debts that the colonized nations owe to the motherland. What debts? How do you calculate debt in a colonial relationship?
I'm glad you raised that because, colonialism is the number one evil, when we talk about the situation currently in Puerto Rico. Just a few days ago, David Gonzalez, the columnist for the New York Times, interviewed a bunch of veterans from Korea, from the famous 65th Infantry, the Borinqueneers, they call them. They've done documentaries on these gentlemen. And they were at a loss to explain, is like, why is it that we can go halfway around the world and fight, for these freedoms and liberties, and then when our countrymen are saying, why do we have to wait 2 weeks to get food, water, medicine to our people? Why, when we clearly went to this side of the world to fight for this country? And also, more concretely, these are hedge fund vultures that have been preying on Puerto Rico for years, the same way they preyed on Greece, the same way they preyed on Spain, the same way they preyed on Argentina. These are tantamount to payday loans, because a lot of them are just high interest loans that are not due maybe for another 30, 40 years at 600% interest rates. And then there's been an ongoing effort to audit this debt, because we believe that this is way, way too shady in terms of what's owed. And we know there's way too many questions, and half of it is illegal, even according to the Constitution.
Let's go back to the question of power. And I don't just mean electrical power, I mean people power. Because clearly what many saw in this latest disaster was a collapse of governance, of that link between Washington and the people of Puerto Rico. How would you reconstruct that link if it was up to you? And how do you reconstruct an economy where governance and the people are in closer relationship?
And that's the key, going back to Casa Pueblo and its trajectory for the last 40 years. They have three pillars. I believe it's science, community, and the arts and culture. They've also, Casa Pueblo were given they forced the government of Puerto Rico to give them people's control of the forest, vast tracts of forest all around the center of Puerto Rico. And so it's called el bosque del pueblo, the people's forest. And they manage that. And they do all kinds of wonderful things with it. They do agriculture. They do they teach the kids from all over Puerto Rico to come in and do botany and do agriculture and do conservation. They do all kinds of scientific experiments there. People even come from actually other parts of the world to study there. In Casa Pueblo itself, they have a science lab, they have a music lab, they have an art gallery. And then very importantly, they have a self-sustained independent radio station.
I saw that.
That's called Radio Casa Pueblo. And that was operating even throughout the storm and was key to connecting the campesinos and the jíbaros all over the island, or in that particular central part of the island, to what was going on. It was key. And we're in the process of trying to, it's a goal, to make all of Casa Pueblo self-sustainable and get solar panels to make all the equipment run on solar panels and solar energy.
So we're out of time, but if you had your druthers and this disaster was turned really into opportunity, what would Puerto Rico look like and how would it operate, 10 years from now?
It would be a self-sustainable economy. It would have our mom and pop shops back in our placitas. Right now, we have more Walmarts and Walgreens and box stores per capita in Puerto Rico than any place else. That money comes straight out of Puerto Rico and goes into Bentonville and other places where these companies are based. So they've killed our mom and pops. We need to get back to that, those local economies, those local restaurants. I've placed my faith in a lot of the young folks in Puerto Rico that are doing phenomenal things. I'll mention one other organization that's called Comedores Sociales de Puerto Rico. As we speak, they're feeding hundreds and hundreds of people in Puerto Rico, and they've been doing it for 4 years. So it's not about just feeding people, but also feeding people. And that's how we're gonna turn this around and make sure that Puerto Rico is off the grid, off this dependency on the U.S. We shouldn't be getting our food from anywhere else. We can grow it in Puerto Rico. We shouldn't be getting fish from Canada. We're surrounded by an ocean. And so Puerto Rico has got to be really concentrated on self-sustainability, getting off the grid by just letting the sun and the wind and the water power us. And it's so doable.
David Galarza Santa, thank you so much for joining
us. Thank you for having me.
Great to have you.